forces black to take back with the pawn at some point. It can be weak, so black prefers to take on c4. It activates the white knight, but black played c6 in advance, so he can keep the bishop on the h2b8 diagonal. Black moves it to c7. And the position seems to be pretty playable. So what black is going to do next? The light squared bishop can go to e6, queen normally goes to e7, and as I said earlier, black can play in the center as well as on the king side. For instance, in one grandmaster game, white proceeded with knight c3, black played bishop e6, queen e2, queen e7, a3, rook ad8, b4 seems to be logical. White advances his pawn minority to weaken black's queenside pawns. Black played a6, rook ab1, rook fe8, rook fc1. White focuses on the queen side, and black in his turn can start his counterplay. His counterplay is normally either in the center or on the king side. In this position, because white already played g3, h5 seems to be logical, so it can be a way to weaken the position of the white king. And in that game, white proceeded with knight d2. And after h4, knight f3, h takes on g3, h takes knight d5. Black seems to have enough counterplay. He can try to bring first one rook to the h5, playing for instance g6, king g7, and then rook h8. He can try to bring the bishop to d5 after he exchanges the knights. In some variations, f4 may work, or g5 followed by f4. Black seems to be fine. Black, as I said earlier, has enough counterplay and can use his bishop pair. Okay, that's it about the Trompowsky system, and now let's see what happens if instead of bringing the bishop to g5, white puts it to f. Okay, and now let's see what happens if white brings the bishop to f4. White plays bishop f4 instead of bishop g5, and it's a so-called London system. Again, I would suggest to push the d-pawn to squares. Black takes control over the center of the board, and now usually white plays e3 to open up a diagonal for the light squared bishop to continue his development on the king side. There are different ways to play this position for black. One popular opportunity, for instance, is to copy white to bring the light squared bishop to f5, but in this case, black should expect and should be ready to play against c4 followed by queen b3 moves. These positions can be sharp, and if black is not well prepared, if black does not know how to oppose white's threats of the queen side, he can run into troubles. So to make it easy, I recommend to play e6 immediately. On one hand, it makes the light squared bishop of black not good. The bishop is limited. But on the other hand, black can develop it on the long diagonal, playing b6, bishop b7, and later on, if he plays c5 and can open up the center, the bishop will be not so bad. And what is also important, the d7 pawn is safe, so black does not need to take care of it if white plays c4 and queen b3. Okay, let's say white develops the kingside knight, knight f3 and c5. So it's very important for black to expand before he plays knight c6. If black does not attack the center, his position is passive. So c5 followed by knight c6 is very popular in this position. And now black in his turn can play queen b6. So if white plays something like bishop e2, queen b6 can be pretty unpleasant for him. Why? Just because black is attacking the b2 point. If white plays b3, he weakens a3 and c3 squares. And it can be sensitive because of the black's dark squared bishop. Or if white plays queen c1, his queen does not look so good. Black can quickly bring the rook to the c-file to target this queen. So instead of bishop e2, white usually plays c3. And what is the difference? The difference if black plays queen b6 at this point, queen c2. Seems to be very natural. The queen is much better placed on c2 than on c1 square. There is no bishop f5 to bother the white queen. And so white seems to be fine. Okay, queen b6 seems to be pretty pointless at this point,